I'm Sheldon.
I'm Ollie.
I'm Ashi.
I'm Stacey.
And I'm Michelle.
And we are going to be presenting a presentation about the prevention of cerebral palsy, which is a medical condition occurring in children. This is a brief introduction of cerebral palsy by Dr. Inga Mathira.
Causes, the preventions, and the statistics of cerebral palsy.
I would agree, all of you, to understand that it is very important to create awareness on the prevention of cerebral palsy. So for that, first we need to look into what are the various causes. It could be a breech presentation, complicated labor and delivery, or it could be low score or NAFLD score, which is a pediatric score, which looks at the heart rate, muscle tone, skin level, breathing, and reflexes of the newborn. And low birth weight or premature birth, because this is another important issue, that in low birth weight or a premature birth can lead to more problems in the developmental domains. So once we have these issues clear, it is important to see that whether the child has associated problems with seizures, and the child has mental retardation, whether there are other issues, we need to look into those aspects carefully. So what exactly prevention is? It is avoiding all that happens from childhood to medical to the larger needles. And even if everything is right, it could be what is being provided is oxygen. If the child has difficulty in crying, it is very important to make sure that without even delay, a fraction of seconds, the oxygen supply should be there. Even if there is a difficulty in crying, make sure the child gets adequate oxygen so that the child moves on the path of holistic development.
It causes motor disabilities and also causes the muscle cord.
important factors at birth and immediate newborn period that affect the future growth and development of the child.
The role of a pediatrician really starts at the birth of the baby. So what I would like to emphasize to all parents and to everybody in the public is that the first minute of the baby's life is perhaps the most important time of his life. This is why we call it as the first golden minute. This is because a baby, as soon as he is delivered into this world, has to expand his lungs. Once his lungs are expanded, there is a lot of oxygen that gets into the baby's brain. And this first golden minute is very important to save this baby's brain for future growth and development. So if, as doctors, we know that there are some situations where, you know, babies may not cry at birth. So the role of a pediatrician starts at minute one. So if a baby does not cry for some reason, we have a lot of equipment to give it oxygen into the brain of the baby. So we are saving this baby's brain for future growth. If a baby does not receive oxygen in the first couple of minutes, it can have irreversible impact on the baby's brain. Apart from this, the first week of a baby's life is also very important because it's the first week that the baby gets nutrition. So I must emphasize that regular breastfeeding is very, very important. Maintenance of normal blood sugar again is very important in the first week of life. And third is, there are some situations where babies get severe jaundice in the first week of life. This could be because of some blood group problems, or it could be because of liver immaturity. Unfortunately, if this jaundice level reaches a critical limit, then it can affect the brain growth, and this can cause, again, a permanent damage on the baby's brain. So the first minute and the first week of a baby's life is extremely critical and extremely important. And the role of a pediatrician cannot be underestimated at this point. So this is what all of us should remember.
Diabetic pregnancies can be more prone, and if a lady has had
previous preterm deliveries or premature deliveries, or has had more number of miscarriages, etc., or if she has other health issues, they can make her prone for prematurity. The cervical incompetence, that is the laxity of the neck of the womb, can also make them more prone for prematurity. These are few causes for prematurity, but in the rural areas, anemia, gross malnutrition, and also hard manual labor can make them more prone for prematurity. Prematurity and intrauterine growth restriction can go together, and it becomes a double-edged sword, which can increase the incidence of cerebral palsy.
Thumbs, the lenses, and they die in 7 months.
Let us see what really happens when there is no oxygen supply to the brain. Certain parts of the brain will decide if there is. And most of the cells in the brain, they are not reversible, so they are irreversible. It doesn't regenerate. So it's not like the skin or the nails or the hair. So when it is irreversible, what happens is that part of the brain cells will be damaged. And if it is depending on the way that exactly the brain cells get damaged, it can affect functions.
Due to the complications in pregnancy. So we have to see whether this baby is truly growth restricted by using growth charts, and also the timing of delivery in such babies is very, very important. We have to depend on what is called as Doppler's, where the blood supply to the baby and the circulation within the baby is studied, and that should guide us in the management of these babies. So it is important that growth restricted babies have adequate care in the form of scans and also these Doppler studies to determine the timing and mode of delivery. We should not be sort of delivering babies prematurely just because they are growth restricted. The maturity is very, very important. That is the one which causes or adds on to the incidence of cerebral palsy.
Prevention of cerebral palsy during delivery. The delivery must take place on time, and the appropriate method of delivery must take place, because there is an incredibly high risk of cerebral palsy if the delivery goes wrong. We say appropriate method of delivery because there's multiple, depending on how the baby is positioned in the womb. You have the standard vaginal delivery, you have forceps, and you have cesarean section as well. And the umbilical cord must be cut as soon as possible, both to avoid infections and so that it doesn't coil around the baby's neck and cause a lack of oxygen going to the brain.
The health of the placenta must be supervised to prevent early rupture of the membranous placenta. And the duration of delivery is around 4 hours, which is very important for doctors and the
mother. Okay, prevention of cerebral palsy after pregnancy. So this is essentially making sure that the child doesn't sustain any injuries. So making sure that the child is vaccinated for common infant infections, eventually like the Zika virus and other reasons. And then using the correct car seat for your child's weight and height, again, reduces the risk of head injuries. And choosing the right crib with the right height so that the baby doesn't fall in or out. Never leaving your child without high countertops or surfaces unattended so that they don't fall. In addition to that, you can also not, we could also say don't put them next to any sharp objects unattended. And then just in general, reducing the risk of head injury. And if the child does have cerebral palsy, physiotherapy or physical therapy must be started as soon as possible. Secondly, prevention is to be. First, we have newborn screening. So newborn screening is essentially a thing that happens a little while after the birth. And every newborn is tested for a group of health disorders that aren't that you can't see directly at the birth. And with simple blood tests, DNA tests and stuff like that, doctors can check for rare genetic, hormone-related and thyroidal disorders that cause serious health problems in the baby. And newborn screening lets the doctors diagnose babies and see if they have any existing conditions and start treatment for them as soon as possible. Second, stem cell research. So the one reason we can't cure CV is because we don't know how to regenerate brain cells and brain tissues. So research into stem cell therapies for cerebral palsy is essentially the remedy to get around that. Unfortunately, it's still at a very early age of development and no proven treatments are currently available. But we have a lot of scientists and doctors are hopeful of succeeding in the near future.
So physiotherapy, which is it's also called as physical therapy. It's often the first step taken towards gradual treatment of
from private hospitals towards prevention or early intervention. In most private or urban hospitals, we have a multi-speciality approach to the whole thing. It's the pediatrician who is at the helm of affairs. He takes the help of a pediatric surgeon, the orthopedic surgeon, ophthalmologist, and the physiotherapist. So it's basically a teamwork that gets good results for these children. As far as the rural areas are concerned, the government is definitely looking at setting up these centers at taluka level hospitals, wherein children from the local areas can come over to the taluka center and avail these facilities.
And we also got to learn new and related topics such as microcephaly and macrocephaly, which is small and mid-sized brain, a baby's head structure.